Granite from the large boulders, which are a feature of the Cornish landscape, has been used over many hundreds of years. Yet it was not until the early 19th century that quarries were worked to satisfy the demands of engineers and architects who were seeking a material that would last forever. Since then, quarrying operations have opened up inexhaustible beds of the highest quality granite, from which very large blocks can readily be got. Cornish granite is not only enduring, it has great beauty. It will withstand the effects of a smoke-laden atmosphere. There is no building stone to equal its resistance to the weathering processes of wind, frost, and rain, and the battering of heavy seas. Cornish granite, used as solid masonry in lighthouses, sea walls, or other exposed places, will endure for hundreds, indeed thousands of years, as this Cornish cross proves. In selecting Cornish granite for the new South Bank River wall, the London County Council have maintained the character of the older embankments on both sides of the river. The wall is about one-third of a mile long, and follows the great convex sweep of the river bank. In vertical section, it has a curved batter. Along the upper part, there is a molded course, which is shown on the drawings by the letter K. Each K stone was given a number by the London office to be used as a key mark at the quarries in Cornwall.
Let's put the cape button now. We'll check that profile.
A full-size cross-section of the wall is drawn out on the floor of the pattern shop. From this setting out, zinc patterns are made and given to the masons and the quarry foreman. Granite was once a molten mass deep below the earth's surface. As it cooled very, very slowly under enormous pressure, its constituent minerals, feldspar and mica, gradually crystallized. Quartz, the hardest constituent of all, was the last to do so. Hence, it acts as the cement which binds the rock together and determines its well-known qualities of extreme toughness and permanence. The aim in quarrying is to dislodge the largest possible blocks. Deep holes are drilled, into which black powder is tamped with wooden rods. High explosive would shatter the rock, but with black powder the explosion can be controlled. In that one block, there are some 2,500 cubic feet of granite, weighing about 250 tons.
Move out nicely.
Now that the rock is fully exposed, it is possible to work out the best way of getting blocks of the required dimensions. In one direction, known as with the grain, granite can be split more readily than across the grain. A line of shallow holes is drilled where the split is required. The splitting is done by plugs and feathers. The feathers and the plugs are made of steel. This is a process calling for skill and experience. When a mason starts work on a stone, his first job is to decide which side is most suitable for the front face. Normally, the front face is trued up first. But as the K-stone has a molded front, the mason starts by truing up the bottom bed. The four corners are leveled off first. The tools used for this are a steel chisel and a short-handled mason's hammer. It takes a mason about a week to dress one of these K stones from start to finish. Here, another mason is cutting a draft around the bottom bed of his K stone. With the drafts complete, the rest of the surface is leveled off with a point tool, making a fair picked finish. An alternative way of getting the fair picked finish is by using a pneumatic pointing machine called a dunter. The bit is a four-point tool known as a dolly point. The two ends are dressed at right angles to the finished bed. And the last job on the ends is the cutting of grapniks. The grapnik is finished off with a pneumatic chisel. The next step is to shape the outline of the molding on the front face. Masks and goggles are worn by the masons for protection against dust and flying chips. This mason is working on the flat surface of the front face of his K-stone. Notice that the bit used in the pneumatic tool is a smaller version of the four-point tool we saw in the dunter. A fine axed finish is wanted for the front face. A special tool is used called a bush hammer, made up of steel blades bolted together. The number of blades and their thickness enable the mason to get a finish of 4, 6, or 8 cut to the inch. The final work on the molding itself can now be done.
Temperature at 2 foot 1 and 13 16.
There are about 6,000 stones in the South Bank River wall, and each was cut and shaped in Cornwall to fit its planned position. Lorries brought the stones from the outlying quarries to Penryn for transport by sea to London. South Bank River wall was built inside a series of cofferdams so that the setting mason could work below water level regardless of tide. When the stones are set side by side, cement grout is poured into the groutnik to bond the stones firmly together. As the beds are not horizontal but radial to the curved batter of the wall, the top bed of this quoin has been sunk in order to form a mitre at the external angle of the wall. The stones are first lowered onto wooden wedges. And then eased onto the cement mortar bed. This completed section of the South Bank wall is a perfect example of how granite should be designed and dressed. The simple dignity of these enduring blocks is in true harmony with the purpose for which they were planned. Although we have stressed how fine Cornish granite is when used in a strong and bold way, it is equally successful in a variety of treatments. Used as solid masonry, it acts both as a load-bearing material and as a decorative surface finish. In stores buildings, shop fronts, and public houses, it is generally used only as a facing. Decorative and bright, it is especially suited for the purpose, and being practically everlasting, is far the most economical in the long run. Office buildings should combine strict utility with dignity and give an appearance of orderly efficiency. Bank buildings should convey solidity and permanence, and both these are striking characteristics of granite, used either in the form of ashlar or in large, polished slabs. Municipal and government buildings lend themselves to the use of granite in plinth and base courses. This well-known example, the London County Hall, shows how well good architectural treatment blends the granite with the stone used above. It is important that granite should be used in the most economical way, that is, with stones of dimensions and surface finish appropriate to the type of building. But bear in mind that to maintain uniform heights of courses adds appreciably to the cost of quarrying. The post office at Falmouth has the ground floor built with granite, used very boldly in rock-faced courses, with an effective axe string to form the transition to the rough cast treatment above. Notice also the finer dressed granite in the window openings. The use of granite in domestic architecture should not be ignored. And when applied to bridge work, there is a wide range of choice. Piers can be faced with coarse rubble. Large blocks, fine-axed to graceful curves, can be used in piers and cutwaters, as in Lambeth Bridge. The massive masonry arches of Putney Bridge make a striking feature. Brent Bridge in Devonshire shows off admirably the use of granite in rural surroundings. In spite of its extreme hardness, granite can be carved with bold and striking effect. Modern methods enable the craftsman of today to work faster and with greater precision than his ancestors could. They spent many laborious months in producing the beautiful decorations on their churches. 800 years ago, men of faith and vision built this church at Launceston. Men wise enough to choose for their building a material as enduring as their religion. A material expression in every sense of the term.